to me from where the thunder hides. I can't outrun this heart I'm tethered to. With every step I collide with you, like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me. Your love is fierce like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce. You cannot fail, you cannot fail. The only thing I've found is through it all, you never let me down. You don't hold back, relentless in pursuit. With every turn, I come face to face with you. Like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love is fierce like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce. You surround me, you chase me down, you seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? You chase me down, you seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? You chase me down, you seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? Like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love is fierce like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce. Your love is fierce. Oh, your love is fierce. Your love is fierce. Like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love is fierce like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce. Lord, thank you for seeking us out this morning, Lord, and drawing us here. Lord, we thank you that nothing can separate us from your love, not even death nor life. And we thank you, Lord, that you are near those that call upon your name, those that seek you. But Lord, we thank you for seeking us out. Thank you for your pursuit of us, Lord. You may be seated. next few songs as we sing them, they're really songs of remembrance and just remembering Him and who He is in our lives and what He's done and what He's accomplished. So as we sing, may you just allow Him to well up thankfulness once again in our hearts and our minds as we worship Him this morning. The Savior alone carried the cross for all of my debts. He paid the cost. Salvation complete. Now forever I'm free. Calvary covers it all. The Savior alone. The Savior alone carried the cross for all of my debts. He paid the cross. Salvation complete. Now forever I'm free. Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My sin and shame don't count anymore. All praise to the one who is ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all. No power on earth, not even the grave, can separate us from mercy and grace. He is faithful to save, oh, His blood never fails. Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My sin and shame don't count anymore. All praise to the one who is ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all. Stand in your freedom. Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My sin and shame don't count anymore. All praise to the one who is ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My sin and shame don't count anymore. All praise to the one who is ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all. All praise to the one who is ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all. All praise to the one who is ransomed my soul. Calvary covers it all. are still my first love, and all I am is yours. You are still my anchor, forever I'm secure. You are still my first love, you're my guiding light. You're with me in the fire, and you lead me through the night. You have my heart, you've won my heart. Oh, how I love you, Jesus. You are my greatest joy. You are still my first love, and all I'm longing for. You'll always be my fortress, my shelter in the storm. Take the bread of life, broken for all my sin. Your body crucified to make me whole again. I will recall the cup poured out in sacrifice, to trade this sinner's end for your new covenant. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Are going to come forward to receive this morning's offerings. What can I give to you? What can I offer to my King for all the love you've shown? For all your mercy over me, soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me.
The rock of salvation, my hope is built on nothing less. Morning by morning, how great is your faithfulness.
I called your name, you heard my cry. Out of the grave and into light, my heart is yours, my soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Let's all stand together. Suffered once for all, you made a way. Jesus, in victory you rose, you made us all your own. Now we are saved. You gave your life upon the cross, you suffered once for all, you made a way. Lord, thank you so much again for saving us, Lord, for redeeming us. Lord, it is a scary thought to think of where we might find ourselves on this day if it hadn't been for you and your grace and your mercy. We thank you. And Lord, as we open your word, Lord, we're reminded that the work that you've begun in us, you have yet to complete. And so we're here, Lord, to ask you to further that work that you've begun in our hearts. May we continue to yield to you as we read your word, in Jesus' name. Amen. And I want you to turn and greet someone next to you, then have a seat.
I'm going to be speaking at your church about the judges, the governor race, senator race, and other candidates and where they stand on the issues, and also the confusing ballot propositions. This nonpartisan review includes what a Christian worldview means and why every Christian must take a stand this election. I hope to see you there.
I just want to invite you guys out to our annual church picnic at Ralph B. Clark Park. Parking is $5 inside the park, or you can park on the street for free and walk on in. And also, don't forget, it is a potluck, so please bring a dish to share, and we'll see you guys there.
Hey, Calvary La Habra. Wanted to invite you guys out to our Chiapas mission trip this summer. The dates are July 7th through the 14th, and our first information meeting will be June 3rd in the Palm Room. If you have any questions, feel free to bring those with you. We're excited to share about the plans for the trip. God bless.
On May 14th, I received a call from Yuval, our tour guide in Israel, and he was so excited. It was the 70-year anniversary of Israel becoming a nation. He quickly sent me videos of people celebrating close to his house on the street corners and said, man, this is happening all around Jerusalem. It immediately got me thinking about our upcoming trip in March of 2019. There's nothing like seeing biblical sites in person. From the deserts of Jordan, man, as we walk through the beautiful canyon of Petra, and we come face to face with the treasury, then into the ancient city, a city that dates back to 400 BC. Then into the coastlines of the Mediterranean, Joppa, where the prophet Jonah embarked upon Tarshish. Then up the coast to Caesarea by the sea, where the first Gentiles would be converted, the home of Cornelius himself, his household, as Peter would go there and he would bring the gospel. We head up north then, and we go through Cana to Nazareth. We go up to Mount Carmel, where Elijah was used to deal with the prophets of Baal. What an incredible Bible study we have in that setting. Then we head up to Megiddo, and we begin to consider Bible prophecy. We begin to open up the book of Revelation and be captivated by the future that awaits all of us. Then we go a little farther up north, and we spend a few days around the Sea of Galilee. We go up on a mountain where Jesus would have taught and gave the Beatitudes. We break off into groups and we read Matthew 5 through 7. We're just taken in by the presence of Jesus and what it was like to hear his voice echo through that canyon. We go to Capernaum, where many of the miracles took place. We go to an ancient synagogue, quite possibly the very places that Jesus walked himself. Up on Mount Hermon, we go to Caesarea Philippi, where Jesus looked around with his disciples and says, "But who do men say that I am?" Then, of course, we jump on a boat ride and we go out on the Sea of Galilee and we open up the scriptures and we think about what it was like for Jesus to walk on these waters, what it was like for the disciples to be caught in a storm and have Jesus calm the wind and the sea. And then we head down towards the Dead Sea, a body of water that lies 1,400 feet below sea level. Body of water that has 10 times the salt content as our oceans. We'll see how impossible it is to sink in that sea. We'll float together and laugh together on that sea. We'll go up to the ancient city of Masada, take in the breathtaking views, and walk through history's account of what happened with many of the Jews who would end their life on that very hill. We'll go to En Gedi, where David was fleeing from Saul. We'll go to the caves of Qumran, and we'll there begin to see where they found the Dead Sea Scrolls. We'll spend our final days in the city of Jerusalem itself. We'll go to the southern steps, where Jesus himself would have sat down and taught as a young boy. We'll go to the western wall for a time of prayer. We'll go to the Temple Mount, and we'll look at the city of Jerusalem, and we'll look at that place where one day, once again, another temple will be rebuilt. We'll go to the Mount of Olives. We'll overlook the Eastern Gate, a gate that Jesus will one day enter through and establish his kingdom, where he will rule and reign for 1,000 years. We'll go to the Garden of Gethsemane. We'll open up the scriptures, and we'll be moved by the heart of Jesus as he painfully wept and cried out to his Father regarding the cross. We'll go to the Pools of Bethesda. We'll read the account of Jesus doing the miraculous. We'll walk through the final days of Jesus' life. We'll go to the quarters of Caiaphas. We'll walk down into a dungeon, into a place where Jesus himself was quite possibly held. We'll also go up to the upper room, an upper room setting where the disciples would have had a final meal with Jesus. Then, off to Calvary, we'll take a look at Golgotha, the place where Jesus was crucified. We'll look at the tomb where most people believe Jesus was laid, where he was raised from the dead, and there we'll sing and we'll worship and we'll take communion. Imagine experiencing all of those sights with your family, the family of Calvary La Habra, having Bible studies together, worshiping, praying with one another, and enjoying some of the most amazing food in that region. We have a few spots left. We're gonna be cutting it off at 100 people. So if you'd like to get more information, please join us on Sunday, June 3rd, down in the cafe, following our second service. Come and meet some of the people going and bring your questions. Can't wait to see you there. God bless you. Toda.
Today is the day we put aside to remember fallen heroes and to pray that no heroes will ever have to die for us again. They chose to reject the fashionable skepticism of their time. They chose to believe and answer the call of duty. They stood for something. And we owe them something. Freedom and the dignity of the individual have been more available and assured here than in any other place on earth. The price for this freedom at times has been high, but we have never been unwilling to pay that price. As for the enemies of freedom, those who are potential adversaries, they will be reminded that peace is the highest aspiration of the American people. We will negotiate for it, sacrifice for it. We will not surrender for it now or ever. We must realize that no weapon in the arsenals of the world is so formidable as the will and moral courage of free men and women. It is a weapon our adversaries in today's world do not have. It is a weapon that we as Americans do have. With God's help, we can and will resolve the problems which now confront us. And after all, why shouldn't we believe that? We are Americans. At the grave of a hero, we end not with sorrow at the inevitable loss, but with the contagion of his courage, and with a kind of desperate joy, we go back to the fight.
Yeah. We're going to have some of our best, our finest, come up and pray. There you go. Reuben and Trevor. Good morning. Good morning.
Morning.
Let's try this one. Mine works. I don't know what's wrong with you, Reuben. There you go. Sorry about that.
Good morning, everybody. As we get ready to honor those who have fallen for us, the Lord's put a scripture on my heart, you know, and I'm going to read it to you guys before we pray. It's coming from John 15, verse 13. Greater love has no other than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. So let us pray. Dear Lord, Heavenly Father, Lord, we're just so thankful, Lord, for this great nation, Lord, that you've given us, Lord. A land of the free and the brave, Lord. And Lord, we're thankful for those that have been called to serve, Lord. The men and women in the uniform, Lord, who are willing to give their lives, Lord, for a greater cause, Lord. Lord, we're thankful for the model that your son, Jesus Christ, has given us, Lord. You know, to lay down his life for us, Lord. We honor those who have fallen, Lord. We remember them, Lord. Their sacrifice that they've given us, Lord. Lord, we also remember their families, Lord, their families who have lent them to us, you know, who no longer are here with them, Lord. Lord, we lift them up in prayer, Lord, that you just comfort them, bring them peace, Lord. And Lord, as we just go on to this day, Lord, we just thank you for their ultimate sacrifice that others may live, Lord. And we thank you and pray for them in Jesus' name.
All right, we're also going to dedicate a little guy. Let's welcome out Grandma and Grandpa here, Sammy and Ileana Mendoza, little Marcos, who's 6 months. Got you. Let me see what you got there, man. Which one you got? Let's see. Oh, dude, that thing is rad. Yeah.
It's way faster.
It's faster, yeah. There you go. Move it back to you. Marcos, come here. What's up, dude? How you doing? What is it in your mouth, brother? Keep it there. There you go. What do you think? That's all about you. He's tripping out. The high calling. Both of you guys. I sometimes have a hard time looking at you guys, and you know why. We start crying because of God's goodness and his faithfulness. And many times I've told you, Sammy, you build my faith. Ileana, you build my faith. And that just tells me you're walking in faith. You guys, I don't know the date, but you just said, we're jumping in, no turning back. And when it was time to take on further responsibility, it's just part of the course. Your heart to just love and to be sacrificial with those who God brings into your life is really a display of Jesus and his sacrificial love that has become real in your life. So, dude, you are in good hands. Good hands. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for this little guy, little Marcos. We thank you for his life, the joy that he's brought to this world, to this home. We are thankful for the faith that embraces him, the faith of a grandma and grandpa that understand how important it is that he would know you and walk with you. So, Lord, bless Ileana, Sammy, as you have, as they make this commitment and lend their life, give their life to make sure this little life knows you. We pray that you would use this little guy, man. He would walk with you. That people would see the faith that's been handed down. Jesus, your life lived out in him. We dedicate him now on this day in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. All right, dude. All right. Okay, I'll take a picture. Look at that. All right, you guys. Love you. All right. See, done. I always ask the people who dedicate their kids in a week or two, I go, hey, they acting any better? You know, and I remind them, well, dedication is really for you. And it's your responsibility. So the question is, are you acting any better? So raising them in the ways of the Lord. So, well, let's turn our Bibles over to James chapter 4, verse 11. We're going to pick up. You saw the announcement that we have a picnic. That's the word, a park picnic today, yes. And you know, you guys see, you probably come to the regular service, your second service people, or maybe you drift back and forth, but there's a whole other part of the church that maybe you would like to meet, and we know that there are a lot of new people that make up the church today. I was recently talking with Francelle about children's ministry, and I'm like, you know, as things grow around here, I said, what do you guys see at that level? And they're signing up about 5 to 10 families a week, new families a week, just in children's ministry. So we know there's a lot of new people and new faces and this service, other services, and throughout the week. And I know a lot of you you're here because you're searching. You would like to maybe find a home church. You'd like to be part of a family, and we don't have a membership. I can't tell you how many people come here. I'm not a numbers-driven guy, but I know that God is into quality and not quantity, and because that's His heart, that should be our heart. And you know, part of that is that family. You know, the DNA that we have when we're born again, we're born into the family of God. That DNA is something that is drawn together and wants to be together. And so, for you that, you know, it's sometimes difficult meet new people around here, come to the park today, come on out. And for you that have been here for a while, I would encourage you to as well show up, bring some food, and make your way to finding some of these new people and say hello. I think it would be great. So, James chapter 4, we've been dealing with, well, this is the third part. I never really do series or anything like that, but in this particular journey through the book of faith, James is very pointed, very candid, very direct, and James he's all about making sure that the body of Christ, he's a pastor, that it is becoming what God has designed the body of Christ to be. And so we got to chapter 4, I was like, wow, there's like three really, really key studies here that I think we can tear apart. And really, he's dealing with conflicts within the body of Christ. So if you are an app person and you're downloading the studies or you go to the website or whatever, we've made this a kind of a package deal, and everything's free, but it's going to say Conquering Conflicts, Part A, or 1, 2, and 3. And so this is the third part of that where he's still dealing with conflicts within the church. And he starts off this chapter with a question. And, you know, we've talked about relationships can be messy. And so the question is, where do the wars, where do the fights, the conflicts, where do they really come from? It's a good question. Then he answers it with another rhetorical question. He's like, hey, don't they just come from your desires for pleasure? And that word desire in the Greek, for you newer people to the New Testament. New Testament was written in Greek, so we look at some of the Greek keywords and we find a deeper meaning. And it's the word hedon. And we derive our word hedonism, hedonistic, from that word, desire. And what hedonism is it's the belief that pleasure is the chief good in life. So how does that play into this question? Well, what ignites the conflicts and the warring in the relationships among us is this inner personal desire to do what's best, to please me, to do what's best for myself, not just in life, but in the conflicts of life. My will, my way, to please me in this conflict is the chief good, and I am going to pursue that at all cost. That's what begins the conflicts and the wars, and that's what continues to fuel the conflicts and the wars among us. And then James says in verse 2, there's something inside of us that continues to grow now, and he says that selfish drive, he labels that as lust. It's an insatiable appetite for that chief desire to be right, or my will, to please myself in the matter, in that conflict. And then he goes, that grows into murder if it's let alone. And we talked about that. What is that murder in my heart as it relates to those I'm warring with and I'm in conflict with? I labeled that. I described that as an inner assassinating that happens in our hearts towards those we war with. We assassinate any kind of respect or appreciation for them. We assassinate any kind of grace, any kind of forgiveness. We assassinate value. Any kind of value we should have towards them, we assassinate that. Any value that anyone else would have towards them, we assassinate that. Any value that God would have towards them, we assassinate that in order to continue the conflict. And one of the reasons that it grows and festers is because, he says in verse 2 there, we don't ask. The idea is that we don't seek God's will in the matter because we're so busy pursuing our will in the matter. Even when we do pray, there he says, you know, we don't receive God's will in the matter because we ask amiss. We're asking with the wrong motives. It's about my kingdom come and my will being done in this matter, not God's. And so James says in verse 4 that this self-seeking pleasure in our heart, that he says it really leads to a major shift in relationships. Conflicts with the body of Christ will really affect our relationships within the body of Christ. And he basically says that we begin to look at those that are blood-bought siblings of the same family with murder in our hearts. And then there's a shift in that relationship, the dynamics of those relationships we're warring with and we're in conflict with. And then he goes, but then there's another shift that happens with those outside the body of Christ, where we then begin to, there's a void, we're empty, we're not, relationships aren't right here. So we start to look at the world and find friendship with the world. And the word world there that he uses is a description of anyone that's living life opposed to God or indifferent towards God. And he goes, you begin to become a friend of them. Talk about a shift in relationships. He says, you know, you should be having this bond, this loving, uniting, peaceful relationship with those that are blood-bought, but you're warring with them. And then with the world that is opposed to God and even opposed to you, you all of a sudden are warming up to them. And when we become a friend of something, anything that we become a friend with, we give our heart over to that. And when we give our heart over to the world, people of the world, we're giving our heart over to people that are indifferent towards God and opposed to God. And before long, that begins to affect us. And then James says, that makes you then an enemy of God. Because they are opposed to God. In that sense, now you will be. Begin to think like them and the philosophy of the world and whatnot. He goes, but take heart. He goes, God doesn't get upset with you. He even calls you guys adulterers and adulteresses, spiritually speaking. We're the bride of Christ, but you've given your heart over to the world. And he goes, but God doesn't get mad at you. It says that his spirit, in verse 5, it's like it dwells in you, and it begins to yearn jealously. What does that mean? That when God sees one of his kids, when the groom sees the bride, we're the bride of Christ, giving their heart over, their affections over to something other than the groom, he grows in greater desire for you. That's amazing. And if that's not enough, the fact that he grows in greater desire for us, he also stands in the ready position to help us. How is that? Verse 6. But he gives more grace. And we talked about that word grace. It's the unmerited favor of God, the help of God. And it's not a word there that's used in reference towards salvation. He's writing to believers that are already saved. It's talking about God's help, God's unmerited favor, God's help that we need to live a life with him in a fallen world. So God will even just well up with greater desire for any of us that might even be growing with this indifference toward God or even oppose God as his kids. That can happen. But at the same time, we're giving our heart over to the world, or we're fracturing relationships within his own family, but he's there welling up for greater desire for us and then standing in the ready to help us. Well, God doesn't force his grace on us, though. God doesn't force us to be saved. And for by grace we are saved through faith. It's a choice. We receive salvation. And the same with the measure of grace that God will give to help us fend off the world, not become a friend to the world. The grace that God would give us, the help that God would give us to reconcile relationships, that help, that grace will not be forced on us. We have a part in this. In verse 6, it says we must humble ourselves to God. God gives grace to the humble. We must submit to God, it says there. When I humble myself to God, I am recognizing the authority of God. He is in charge and I am not. But when I submit to God, I am surrendering my will to his will. I will now do what he says, not just recognize what he says. Thirdly, we must draw near to God. Why is that important? Because we actually determine how intimate we will be with God. He already stands there as a jealous God, wanting more of us, standing there ready to receive us and help us. But he won't force that on us. Jeremiah 29:13 says, "You will seek me and find me if you search for me with all of your heart." He didn't force himself on anyone. Psalm 145:18, "The Lord is near to all who call upon him in truth." What else must we do? Verse 8, purify our hearts. In the Greek, that speaks of making chaste. It's a call for the bride of Christ to renew themselves once again to the groom, Jesus. Verse 9, we must also lament and mourn and weep. We need to be completely devastated over the effects of our sin, over broken relationships in the body of Christ, over unhealthy relationships outside of the body of Christ. What else? That brings us to verse 11. What else should we be doing or not doing? Do not speak evil of one another, brethren. Some people hear that and go, well, then what are we going to talk about? He says, well, he who speaks evil of a brother and judges his brother speaks evil of the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you're not a doer of the law, but a judge. There's only one lawgiver who's able to save and destroy. And who are you to judge one another? And so he starts off and he's like, okay, you want to conquer some conflicts? He said a whole lot, but now you need to really watch what you say. Don't be speaking evil of anyone in the church. How many of you guys know that most of the battles in the church don't happen with closed fists, but with open mouths? It's sobering to hear this, that the church needs this strong pointed command. Don't be speaking evil of one another. And then the church also needs the reasoning behind it. Now, in chapter 3 earlier, we know that the church had a problem with the tongue, and we have 12 verses on dealing with the tongue. In chapter 1, verse 19, he would tell us as the church, be swift to hear and slow to speak. In chapter 1, verse 26, he said that a believer who does not bridle his tongue is not truly religious. In chapter 2, verse 12, He reminded believers that we are to speak and act as though we are already facing the judgment of God. And now, a very direct hit. Don't be speaking evil against one another. Some of your translations, another, I think it was NASB or whatever, it might say, don't slander one another. In the Greek, if you break this down, it's basically saying, do not speak down on one another. Don't be speaking against one another. Don't be speaking down on one another. And it's a greater idea than just a greater concern than slander. Slander is malicious speech that is not true. But this command encompasses any speech that runs down a person, whether it's true or not. Some people think it's okay to say whatever they want to say about people as long as it's true. Others say, I can say whatever I want to say as long as it's to their face and it's not behind their back. But the Bible, James here, is saying that we need to refrain from any speech which intends to run a person down, whether it's true or not true, whether it's to their face or not. And hear me. The Bible categorizes such evil speaking as sinful, as immoral. And when the Bible talks about evil, it's talking about what is morally reprehensible. It's talking about what is morally wrong in God's eyes. And so when Paul in Ephesians 6, verse 13, says that we are to take up the whole armor of God, remember that, and that we may be able to stand or withstand in the evil day, he's talking about a time. He's talking about society, a time in society where society has shipwrecked morality. Kind of like in the days of Noah in Genesis 6, 5 through 6, where it says the wickedness of man was so great on the earth that every thought and every intent of his heart was only evil continually. God looked at mankind, he's like, wow, right now, what you think is morally wrong in my eyes. What you are doing, the way you guys are speaking, society as a as a general description, it was morally wrong in God's eyes. It's like in the days of Judges, where everyone was doing what was right in their eyes. Or in Isaiah's days, where it says in Isaiah 5, 20 and 21, where people were calling good evil and evil good. We live in those days. Whatever is morally wrong, the Bible says that's evil. I think that we all understand that lying is immoral. It's evil. I think most of us, our moral compass as Christians would say, you know, that's wrong, and we should feel really wrong if we lie. I think the same is true for stealing. I think that most of us, our moral compass, would look at someone who's stealing and go, that's wrong. And if we did that, we would feel like that is really wrong. This morning I was making my pit stop and went to get my cup of coffee, and oftentimes there's a few guys around town I talk to. They kind of live on a street, and so I saw one of them and I pulled over. We were talking, and you know, hey, what's going on? And you know, and sat there and ate a little bit and talked a little bit, and I said to this young man, I said, you know, how was it last night? He goes, it was a long night, but he goes, I just want you to know. He goes, I'm not what everybody around here thinks I am. And I go, well, okay. He goes, no, I'm a really good guy. And I says, you're a really good guy. He goes, yes. He goes, I was going around today picking up some change, and I walked by the bank over there, and he's like, well, check this out. And he goes, I found that ATM card. And I says, whose name is on that ATM card? He didn't look at the card, but he knew the name. He knew. He knew that it was wrong. And he goes, you know, I'm just trying to figure out what to do with this card because God told me that's not your card. He knew he was wrong. Like, I could help you with that card. Give me that card. So I went and used it. I got a little extra cash, you know. But I think we all realize that lying is morally wrong. We all realize and we believe that stealing is morally wrong. Now, hear me. It's evil. Can you say that? Not out loud, it's evil. Equally so, passing along damaging information about another person in the body of Christ. And then, I would say even outside of the body of Christ, it's dealing with specifically here within the body of Christ, but it's true too with respect to anybody. Passing on damaging information is evil. It's morally reprehensible to God. And the early church and many in the church today are guilty of it. In 1 Peter chapter 2 and again in chapter 3, Peter says this, summarizing it. Two times there he says, you know, church, you should expect slander and evil speech from those outside the body of Christ towards those in the body of Christ. You should expect that as believers, but it should not be named among us. He puts it this way, 1 Peter 2, 1 through 3, therefore laying aside all malice, all deceit, all hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking. Lay it all aside as like newborn babes, just desiring the milk of God's word. Go back. You're acting infantile. Just go back to just the word of God and that you may then begin to grow thereby, if indeed, almost question mark behind that, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Paul would say in Ephesians 4, 31 and 32, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and all evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And he goes, just be kind to one another. And tenderhearted and forgiving and he gives a standard, even as Christ forgave you, you also go do that. All of those sins, you look at that, the bitterness, the wrath, the anger, you know, the evil speaking, it's sin that breaks fellowship and destroys relationships. Paul warned the Galatians, Galatians 5, 14 through 15, but, you know, for all the law is fulfilled in one word, even this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. We'll come to that in just a minute again. But if you bite and devour one another, beware lest you be consumed by one another. Listen, if we've humbled ourselves to God and truly submitted to Him, we're not going to be speaking evil of others. If we're drawing near to God, if we're sincerely devastated over our sin, over broken relationships in the body of Christ, we're not going to be speaking evil of one another. Proverbs 8:13 says, the fear of the Lord, an awe and a reverence of God, living that out is to hate evil. 1 Thessalonians 5:22, abandon or abstain from every form of evil. 1 Corinthians 13:5, the love chapter. Love doesn't even think. It thinks no evil. Proverbs 3:7, do not be wise in your own eyes, for fear the Lord and depart from evil. So what else does he say? In close connection to the warning, to the command, excuse me, don't be speaking evil of one another. Next, number 7 in our series here, don't be judging people as well in the body of Christ. Verse 11, he who speaks evil of a brother and judges his brother speaks evil of the law and judges the law. Now the idea behind this word to judge is not the idea of personal evaluation. The idea behind this word judge is personal condemnation. For a Christian, I think you would agree with me, for a Christian to have a critical view of others and express that, they got to have a pretty high view of themselves. And we know that that's pride. And pride will always create a distorted view of who we are. It will create an elevated view that minimizes others and leaves us feeling we are better, we know better, and we do better. Jesus nailed this in Luke chapter 18, where he was telling a parable about people who trusted in themselves, a reference to some Pharisees that were there. And he goes, there was a couple of guys who went to the temple to pray. They came to church just like us. And one was a tax collector and one was a Pharisee, a familiar passage to many of us here. But the Pharisee, the guy who just trusted in himself, he prayed this way. I thank God that I'm not like other men, extortioners and unjust and adulterers and even like this guy next to me. Could you imagine you're in worship service here and the person next to you is like, Lord, I just thank you that I'm just so on fire for you and I'm so right with you, not like this person next to me. Man, I just thank you, Lord. I'm not just like the little insignificant struggling people like the person turned around to you behind me. Imagine what that would do to their heart. Imagine what that would do to the heart of God. And then he said this. I fast twice a week, and I give tithes of all that I possess, you know. And he's like, you know, Lord, you know, man, I was the first one here today. I've been praying since I got up. I've been fasting, and as you look around, they're sucking in their cheeks, you know, in their stomach. Oh, you know, I'm such a spiritual person. Man, the offering plate came along. I gave the most. And just this whole weird thing. And it says, Jesus says next, but then the tax collector who walked in, he would not as much even raise his eyes to heaven. He beat his chest. And he says, God, have mercy on me. I'm a sinner. And Jesus said, I tell you, this guy went down to his house justified rather than the other. For anyone who exalts himself is going to be humbled. And those that humble themselves are going to be exalted. What was it? It was spiritual pride that caused that Pharisee to see himself as better and more important. It was spiritual pride that caused him to, listen, belittle, speak evil, and judge a man next to him in church. Matthew 7, a familiar passage again. Jesus, verse 1 there says, judge not that you not be judged, for with the judgment you judge, you will be judged. Whatever measure you use, guess what? It's going to be measured back to you. No minced words there. Don't judge, lest you be judged. There's some people who run with this, and they feel like there's never a time to assess a personal evaluation. cast a personal evaluation on another person. They believe that we're to be totally accepting whatever the situation. We live in a non-believing world today, by far, that has the posture that says you need to tolerate. They're pushing toleration on everyone. Everybody is entitled to their own choices, their own views, their own beliefs. No one has a right to judge others. No one has a right to share their opinions with others. To each his own. Everybody's entitled to discern truth. Whatever they feel truth to be, that's what it is. It's interesting that this non-believing world that cries out for so much toleration and says you have no right to cast your opinion on society, they have their darlings, don't they? They have their heroes that they want to cast opinions on politics, on foreign affairs, on the earth, on spotted owls, on whales. The list goes on. But it's interesting that when it comes to matters relating to individual morality, God's view of morality, biblical morality, that same non-believing world says you have no right to give an opinion. You have no right to judge. Society today, non-believing society, adores non-judgmental people. They want everyone to keep their moral opinions to themselves, and they parade that. That's the world we're living in today. But this is not what Jesus means when he says, do not judge, or you too will be judged. We know Jesus did not mean this, because as we read through the text, Jesus says, listen, later on he goes, don't be giving to dogs what is sacred, and don't throw your pearls before swines. We couldn't obey that command unless we judge who are dogs. What's he referring to there? And what are the pigs? What is he referring to there? A few verses later, in verse 15, he says, you guys need to be watching out for false prophets. They come in sheep's clothing. And inwardly, though, they're ravenous wolves. We wouldn't be able to assess that if we didn't cast some form of judgment towards that. So what is it that Jesus is saying? When he says, do not judge, he's saying, refrain from any kind of hypocritical, condemning judgment that is destructive, not constructive. And then he gives a warning, for with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. Whatever measure you use, it will be measured to you. And really what he's saying is, hey, listen, there's some eternal effects to all of this. You go around judging everybody. Understand, as a Christian, one day you're going to stand before the greatest judge. The supreme judge. 2 Corinthians 5, 10 through 11, Paul talks about that time at the judgment seat where God's going to be handing out rewards. Judgmental behavior is bad. It will not produce a reward. And I'm sure none of us would ever pray, you know, God, judge me as I judge my fellow friends. But you don't have to. You don't have to. He will. He's going to judge us as we judge others. And the tone of our life is going to reflect the tone of our judgment. And then he drives the point home, and I always like this point in verses 3 and 5. He says, why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but do not consider the plank in your own eye? How can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck in your eye, and there's a plank in your eye? He's like, hypocrite. Jesus judged. Hypocrite. First remove the plank in your own eye, and then you'll see more clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. The idea is before we can even properly deal with other people's sins, their failures, their faults, we got to deal with ours. And you know, there's just something about coming to God with our own failure when we honestly do that. There's a humbling that happens in us that changes how we then begin to see others. He's like, you first deal with a telephone pole in your eye, Lance. And you can start dealing with a speck of sawdust in someone else's eyes. Almost humorously, sarcastically saying that. The idea is like, look, man, it'd be comical to even try and do that, if not impossible. He who speaks evil of a brother and judges a brother speaks evil of the law and judges the law. But you, if you judge the law, you're not a doer, but a judge. What's he saying? He's saying that when we speak evil of people and we judge people, we're exalting ourselves above the law. Well, what law? Well, remember back in chapter 2, verse 8, he talked about the royal law, loving our neighbor as ourself. Romans 13:10 says, love is the fulfillment of the law. The idea is when we judge people hypocritically or condemningly, we are breaking the law of love. And if we violate this command, we are elevating ourselves above the clear teaching of God's word. Failing to keep it amounts to judging it. And in that, you have judged it to be invalid in your life and for your life. In that you're above it. We are not to judge the law. We are to obey it. 12, there is one lawgiver who is able to save and destroy. Who are you to judge one another? In that Matthew 7 passage, Jesus does tell us that we could be fruit inspectors in people's lives, that we can see and observe outward behaviors. And, you know, when he talked about being aware of the false prophets. And he's like, look, they come to you in sheep's clothing, but they're really ravenous wolves. Well, he was like, observe that. And then he goes, you're going to know them by their fruits. Outwardly, that's how you know that that's what they are inwardly in that sense. Because every good tree bears good fruit. Every bad tree bears bad fruit. The idea is, he's like, you keep your eyes fixed on the outside because you really don't know what's going on the inside. We cannot judge what we don't see. We can't see man's heart. We can't see their motives. We can't see their thoughts. God uniquely is qualified to do that. He sees everything. You know, when people are falsely accused, they will often say, you don't know my heart. And that's true. But God does. In order for judgment to be just, the heart must be judged. In order for the heart to be judged, it must be seen. And God is the only one that can see the heart, thus he's the only one that can judge. For us to usurp, or for us to judge another person, is to usurp a right that God alone has. So the question, who are you who judge another? You know, would you take God's place? You want to pull that on God? And then James begins to wind this down, and he begins to talk about the heart here. He talks about arrogance in the heart. A very, very sobering conclusion to this passage, this part of it here in verse 13. He says, you know, come now, you who say today or tomorrow we will go to such and such a city and spend a year there and buy and sell and make a profit, whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that. But now you boast in your arrogance, but all such boasting, and here's the word again, is evil. It's interesting, we see pride here, we see criticism here, and now we see really arrogance or self-confidence all kind of work together. Humble people submit to God's will. Proud people, they're all about their will. James pictures here the mindset of the proud, the self-confident, arrogant person. In verse 13, he's like, they look at life as this never-ending thing that they themselves control. They plow through life boasting about their deeds and their deals and their plans and their successes with no thought of God, with no thought of seeking the will of God in those matters. They're self-confident, they're self-assured, and they're arrogant about it. We will go. We will buy. We will sell. Today, tomorrow, and next year. And they do that with a self-confidence, with a self assurance, with confidence in their own ability, their own proficiencies. Their pride blinds them from the obvious uncertainties in life. Their pride makes them presumptuous. Presumptuous in their today, that they can do whatever they want today. Presumptuous in their tomorrow, as if they're even going to have a tomorrow, and continue that same mindset tomorrow. We got it all figured out. Listen. Living without serious references to God's will is practical atheism. I'm going to say it again. Living without serious references, dependence on God's will, is practical atheism. You can't define it any other way. But there's a glaring problem facing those kind of Christians, those kind of people. Verse 14, whereas you don't know, you really don't know what will happen tomorrow. A year? What are you talking about? You could die tomorrow. None of us knows what will happen tomorrow. None of us knows what tomorrow holds financially, relationally, medically, or prophetically. We don't know. Tomorrow we could all wake up and it's like, man, I've been needing a Monday off, and you start grilling and the trumpet blows, man. And rather than eating hot dogs in your backyard, you're staring at the marriage supper of the Lamb. Bring it on, by the way. None of us knows what tomorrow will hold. I got a call in the middle of the night last night with regard to someone facing death. Nobody knows. I got a call 2 weeks ago from Jim Stewart, who's taught here before in Kansas City, and he calls me up. He goes, well, I'm really glad to hear your voice. I go, oh, what's going on? He says, well, yesterday was almost my last day on the planet. What happened, Jimmy? Oh, you know, KC, living back in KC, we got these tornadoes. He goes, you know, I was out speaking with Lowe. We were driving. It was late night. We were coming back in and just listening to worship music, whatever it was. And well, when the tornadoes start getting close, it knocks out all of our cell towers. And just, I wasn't getting any text until I got a little closer to town. And then my phone just tink, 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 tink. And there it was, my boys, Dad. Have you heard about the tornado? Dad, find shelter. Dad, are you in shelter? And then he goes, I come into town, and I see there's nobody in Kansas City. Nobody. No cars on the road, just me and Lowe driving in. It's like 8 o'clock at night. We're driving in. No one's around, and he looks at Lowe, and he goes, we're in trouble. And he goes, the tornado was right on top of us. And he goes, I saw it coming behind me. We started driving through town, talk about running signals. We're flying. Finally, we came to this one signal. We had to stop. And he goes, our car started moving side to side. And he goes, Lance, I seriously thought that was it. And Lowe had been telling me for the last 10 minutes, go into that shelter, go into that shelter. And he goes, you know us guys. So I asked Jim, when will she be back? That was a joke. We don't know. None of us here. I remember being in high school, 10th grade, hanging out with my friend Robbie Garrett, talking about what we're going to do all next week. 10th grade. It's summer. We had it all figured out. And I'll never forget his dad weeping that afternoon as he called me and said, Robbie's gone. He's gone. It was hard for me as a 10th grader. None of us are promised tomorrow. So as we look at this, what is your life? It's a vapor that appears for a little time and then even vanishes away. It really is so uncertain. King David in Psalm 102 says, my days are like an evening shadow. You guys know an evening shadow. It's there for a little while. And then night comes, and that shadow's gone really quick, is it not? Forever. Psalm 102:3, David said, for my days vanish like smoke. Poof! How many of us that are in our 30s now can look back and we're like, man, those first three decades, poof, right? We realize that as we get a little bit older. If we truly believe this, it will radically affect our plans for tomorrow. And hear me, it will radically affect how we treat people tomorrow. I'm around death a lot, more than I want to be. And I have yet to be with a family that doesn't want to make things right with the person that's about to go home or vice versa. Something about this is sobering. Can hedonism, this insatiable desire to be right in matters, play out, develop such an arrogance that I'm going to pursue my will, and I begin to do that, I begin to be so confident in my will that I actually think I can dictate my tomorrow? Nah, that's not wise. He says, instead you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we shall live and do this or that, or if the Lord wills, that's the right mindset. That's the mindset of being dependent on God. I know for many Christians, this is cliche stuff right here. Hey, I'll see you tomorrow, God willing. I send a text to someone, I'm going to be, God willing. If you're living your life as a Christian, and you're really not slowing down and bringing God's heart, God's perspective, God's will into the matters of life, relationships in life, decisions in life, choices in life, then I guarantee you are setting yourself up for a very unsettling season. You say, what's that? How many of you guys know, everybody in this room, that life isn't fair? Oh, some of you have lived some life. The rest of you, you're not with us. How many of you guys know life is going to be really hard? Yeah, really hard. But how many of you guys know that when life is difficult and hard, if you're in the will of God, you got a settling in your soul? I've talked to people that are in relationships that they just blasted forward with. It's my will in the matter. And then the hardships come upon every relationship, and they experience it, and there's no settling in their soul. People on a career path, same thing. People in ministry, same thing. People going down some educational road. Just running ahead because I'm in control today. I can be in control tomorrow. And they haven't developed in their walk this conviction to really find God's will in matters. To where they just really live. Well, let me see what God's will is in this matter. If God wills, I will spend my time. If God wills, I will spend my talent, my treasure. If God wills, I will wake up tomorrow and live out what He wills for my tomorrow. And James says, outside of that, this whole idea is it's boasting. All such boasting, that kind of confidence, living your life outside of the will of God, is just, it's evil. It's evil. Therefore, lastly, verse 17, to him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him that is sin. So James hits this whole idea of the sins of omission. We have the sins of commission. What's the sins of commission? Well, the sins of commission, when I know God forbids me to do something, don't do that. And I do it. That's the sin of commission. The sin of omission, to know to do good. To know to do good and not do it. That's also sin. And so if we were reading this little letter, we got this letter right now, and we're just a church, and I'm like, hey, we got another letter. This is from Pastor James, inspired by the Holy Spirit. If we just read through this letter, do you know that right now it's taken us a few weeks, but it would have taken us about 8 minutes to get to this point in the letter? Just eight, you know. So what James had to say about trials, you got to live it out. What James had to say about temptation, got to live it out. What James had to say about not being partial, showing partiality in the church, got to live it out. What James said about the tongue, got to live it out. When he said, you got to be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath, got to live it out. When James says, love, supreme, love your neighbor, love each other, got to live that out. When James basically says in chapter 4, don't be warring. Don't be conflicting with people. When he says, humble yourself to God. Draw near to God. When he says, purify your hearts. When he says, oh man, weep and mourn and lament over the relationships that aren't right. Gotta live it out. And he says, don't be a friend to the world. Gotta live it out. He says, don't be speaking evil. Don't be judging. Gotta live it out. To that person who knows that and doesn't do that, that's the sin of omission. We got to live it out. Now, about a month ago when I was, 6 weeks ago, I was looking at all this. I was looking ahead in my Proverbs studies. I told you guys, I think it was this church group here. I'm like, man, I think God wants to get the family together and have a heart to heart. This is where we're going. I wish, maybe there'll be a day when we all, like most of us, are together in one room. And, you know, dad. You guys, I was raised with a dad. When dad said, we're having a family meeting, you were on time and you were alert and you paid attention. But sometimes there's just a season in a church where, and I knew this going to the book of James because it's so direct. I knew that there would be this heaviness. Like, going through this book, I have been interacting on a regular basis through text, emails, phone calls, relating to this book with more people that don't come to this church than do. There's thousands of our Bible studies that are downloaded and listened to every month. And there's people where I believe who aren't as familiar. How many of you guys know that familiarity can breed contentment? It's the familiar voice. God's voice should never be that familiar. But there's a lot of people on the ready. They're like, I need something. And some of you have been passing these studies on, and I've been seeing God use this insight he's giving our church to touch a broader group of people throughout the world. The question is, have you done with this? We only got one more chapter. I'm going to milk this last minute for all it's worth. We only got one more chapter. I'll milk 10 more studies out of it if you have to, but we only have so much time. How are you doing with this? I'm just going to ask the question. Have any relationships been altered by you because God spoke to you through James 4. We all got some work to do somewhere. I know that. In our home, outside of our home, we all do. Tomorrow, today, will you look a little bit different regarding the will of God? The whole, I don't know if I have it tomorrow. Our beloved Dave Greer, who our big Samoan brother here, who loves to work the soundboard and loves to eat. That was the call I got last night. He had a stroke. And one of our members here who's a paramedic in the city of Huntington Beach texts me in the middle of the night. And I call him. We're en route, but we got him. And me and my buddy, we're praying over him. We're laying hands on Dave right now. And out of all the places, you know, and you're like, oh, this is good. Nobody's promised tomorrow. As I finally found Dave and got him on the phone, he tells me, oh, dude, that was a trip. They caught the stroke in time. And they think he's going to be okay. Man, that was a trip. He goes, there's nothing like, you know, I'm there and these doctors are looking at me, Lance, and they're telling me, you know, look, Dave, there's a big decision you're about to make, and we're going to give you this medication, and it's going to tell us if it's one thing or another, but we got to do it now to save your life, buddy. And there's a certain percentage of people that respond to this fatally. Dave's telling me this. Dude, I had to make a choice to put something into my body that could have been fatal. I go, dude, you were a drug addict most of your life. What's the deal? Come on, all of a sudden you care? That's what he did. That's why I know he's going to be okay. Can you ever be serious, Lance? You know? No. That should change. That should change you. This church, the last month, has been rocked by death. Radicals. It should change who we are. These passages should radically alter the circumstances now. If that doesn't happen, don't just go, oh, yeah, my heart's getting a little harder, I'll get around to it. No, it could be omission. It could just be omission. God, I know what you're saying, but no. A no to God saying, do this, is sin. How serious does God take sin? In your mind's eye right now, picture Jesus hanging on a cross, brutally beaten and whipped. Picture his tears, bloodshot eyes. He was all about that for anything God's already forgiven us for. He was all about that for this thing right now that you're saying, nah. No. Not that. Now, his blood is powerful enough. He died for a purpose. Past, present, and future sins. He died so that he's the God of reconciliation, so that we would be made right with him and right with others. He died to set relationships right. Beginning between us and him, then this body, and that should alter our relationship to the world. Where is your heart? You a friend of God? You a friend of the body of Christ? You going to show up at the picnic today? This is serious stuff. God altered this building from an Alpha Beta store to be a sanctuary where one day you and I could walk in right now and encounter his son. He did that with this very second in mind, so that his spirit could speak to all of us so that we would not be the same. Don't say no to that. Lean into that, embrace all of that. And let your tomorrow be what he's designed it to be. That begins today. Let's pray. We thank you, Lord, again, for the time we have together in these settings. We thank you for the work you begin, you are faithful to complete. Our part is to yield. Our part is to humble. Our part is to submit. Our part is to yield. Oh, Father, have your own way, as the song, the hymnist would say. You are the potter, we are the clay. Mold me, make me after thy will. And may many, many, many around us be touched by you because we yielded to you. A work that began in us will be a work that you continue through us to the benefit of others. That's kingdom work. That's ministry to your glory. We thank you and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Love you guys.
How you guys doing? Have a great Memorial Day today. We're going to be at Ralph B. Clark Park. If you guys don't know where that's at, down Euclid, make a ride on Rosecrans and be on your left-hand side. We'll be, I think we're doing some hamburgers and some kind of sausage, something like that. I think that's what they're doing. Is that what he said we're doing? But bring something to share with us as well. So what a great message, huh? What a great message. We all have muddy relationships, dirty relationships that need to be fixed. And thank you, Lord, for your word. I really appreciate Proverbs 27 that we've gone through that talks about relationships and then how to now work out our conflicts in a relationship, because every relationship has conflicts or else it's not a relationship. So that means all of us. We all have conflicts, but thank you guys, and if you guys need prayer for anything, our prayer team will be up front. Hope to see you guys at the park. God bless you guys.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. No one like you. beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Precious cornerstone, sure foundation.